The Household Cavalry has dual roles. 250 horses and men serve the Queen as her ceremonial bodyguard. At the same time, the other half of the regiment is ready to go to war. This time on the Queen's Cavalry, there's chaos in the countryside. Vagabond takes Trooper Wakefield for an unplanned swim.
This is a big shot. I knew something was going to happen today.
The armoured regiment are off to tank driving school.
Do that on your test. Failed. Right, we failed that.
And the mounted regiment receives the latest recruit, Freddy. He's ridden for the very first time.
Whoa, Stan. Big pat and cool bets.
Windsor is home to the Household Cavalry's training wing. 16 new recruits arrive at Combermere Barracks for day one of basic training. The man responsible for transforming them into cavalry blacks is Warrant Officer Joe Weller.
Don't get in front of them, otherwise you'll get trampled. All these horses are generally between 4 and 5, sometimes a little bit younger, and they're all bought from Ireland.
All the horses are selected from traditional draft stock. These shaggy beasts arrive untamed and unridden. It was Charles II who first insisted that the regiment's horses must be black. He believed that black mounts, more than any other, struck fear into the hearts of the enemy. They must be no less than 16 hands high, standing nearly 6 foot at the shoulder.
You keep walking, his head up, the left likely to fall on his face, that's it.
Joe has spent most of his life working with horses and is a specialist in breaking them in.
Just stop him there.
It's a lovely little horse, this.
Just as a soldier has a dog tag, every horse has their hooves branded with an army number.
And that's the 8,181 horses come through the cavalry on record. Great, you need
this one. Year, all new horses will receive a name with the letter F, just like a car registration. It's a tradition to continue the names of famous horses from the past. Joe has taken a particular interest in 8126.
Little boy, see if we get him on the trooping of the colour. OK, cool, Major, thank you.
This latest recruit will be called Freddy, in honour of the only Household Cavalry horse to survive the Boer War. During the campaign, the average trooper got through 6 horses. Conditions are much better for today's Freddy. He can expect to serve at least 15 years with the regiment.
Straight from the field, look. He's settling down quite well there with a bit of hay. If we can have a comparison to a human being, I would have said it's day one in the army. It's very much like the recruits on their first day in the ride, and there's some very nervous ones there. But now he's come in with his friends. He's now settled again.
It will take months of gentle handling and skillful horsemanship to transform Freddy into a fully-fledged ceremonial horse. All new horses who join the regiment stand in the shadow of the most famous cavalry black ever, Sefton. On the 20th of July 1982, the Queen's Lifeguard rode out of Knightsbridge Barracks to be blown up by a remote-controlled IRA nail bomb.
Between 5 and 10 pounds of plastic explosives had been hidden in a blue Austin car. The blast started a day of carnage and confusion in London.
4 members of the guard and 7 horses were killed. Sefton survived the blast, but suffered 38 horrific wounds. Knightsbridge Barracks was inundated with get-well cards, letters, carrots, and over 300,000 polo mints. As an anxious British public followed his remarkable recovery, he became a household name. He lived to the grand old age of 30. Today, Sefton's memory lives on in his current namesake, called Sefton, an 18-year-old Blue and Royal veteran. This morning, he's due to leave the regiment after a lifetime of service.
He's done the work for us over the years, and now it's time for him to have a bit of a rest.
Traditionally, retiring horses are clapped off the yard by their troop. Sefton has secured a place in the same horse retirement home in Buckinghamshire as his predecessor, where he can see out his days in 5-star luxury. He will be doted on by yard manager Shirley Abbott.
Hello, May. This is your new home. Little baby. You're a good boy. It's
going to be very strange for Sefton because he was still doing ceremonial duties yesterday. The old Sefton came here after the Hyde Park bombing, which is over 20 years ago now, and he was one of the most badly injured. I think he was 30 when he died, and new Sefton has come to replace him. So if he lives as long as he did, because Sefton's only 18, he's got a good few years of happy retirement, hopefully.
Sefton has seen the last of the city and military duties, and can now enjoy a peaceful retirement. The industrialisation of warfare in World War I saw shell and machine gun fire drive the household cavalry from their horses and into the trenches. But by World War II, the cavalry's traditional role was reinstated. They returned to battle, mounted on iron horses. Today, the armoured regiment uses fast, lightweight tanks, scimitars. Their role? Rapid reconnaissance. Just like their contemporaries in the riding school, every trooper has to tame 8 tons of tracked vehicle capable of 60 miles per hour. Trooper Jason Glasgow is fresh out of basic training, having joined the regiment in Jamaica.
I had the option was to go either mounted or armoured. And I choose armoured first just to get the experience, because it's a good experience, you know, to go out on operations, you know.
Sergeant Danny Stewart is responsible for turning new troopers into battlefield tank drivers.
A lot of the driver, the vehicles go nowhere, okay, so its combat effectiveness is zero.
But before they are let loose anywhere, they must first learn how to manoeuvre their vehicle precisely through a tight course of cones.
I just concerned about the cones. You know, that is my only concern, just the cones, because if you fail your cones, they don't cry out on the road, so kind of worry about the cones, but keeping my fingers crossed.
With 10 gears and levers instead of a steering wheel, Jason is having a tough time avoiding the cones. He appears to be waging a one-man war against anything orange and white. Danny is unimpressed with Jason's cone carnage.
Failed. You turned and you carried on turning without adhering to my hand signals. It's a fail.
Thinking about driving in a car is nothing like driving in a tank. Everybody could tell you that it's difficult, you know. And we're constantly changing up and changing down, and it's just one clutch. Press down to change up, press up to change down. So you understand it's totally different.
Watch mirrors, watch what I'm doing.
Unless Jason can find his way through the cones, it's going to be curtains for his tank driving career. It's week 10 for the trainee troopers of the riding school. There's less than 2 months to go until pass out. We've seen them take their first steps, suffered some serious falls, and take part in their first major ceremonial duty. The household cavalry take tremendous pride in their history. As part of their training, the ride are in Somerset for a battlefield tour of Sedgemoor. After 10 weeks of training, it's the very first time the troopers have escaped the confines of the riding school. Trooper Liam Wakefield is unsure what to expect.
With a name like Sedgemoor, you just know it's going to be a wide open space. So if you fall off your horse and it buggers off, loads of acres and you find it.
In 1685, the last land battle on English soil was fought here, at Sedgemoor. It was the first time all the regiments of the Household Cavalry fought together for their king. The tour starts at the pub with a traditional glass of port.
Well, thank you very much.
Their guide, regimental historian Major General Barney White Spanner. On the night of Sunday, 7th of July, 1685, the Royal Army camped here. Whilst they enjoyed large amounts of local cider, a rebel army was planning a surprise attack. The troopers ride in the hoofprints of the Household Cavalry of 350 years ago, commanded then by the Grand Old Duke of York, James II. The Duke of Monmouth and his Protestant ragtag rebel army wanted to take the throne from his Catholic uncle.
Monmouth's army is rubbish, effectively. He's got 800 horse, but they're nothing like as well-trained as our three regiments are. Monmouth's lot have come together in the space of 3 weeks, and you can't possibly, I hope as you'll realise, having done this riding school course, you cannot produce people as trained cavalrymen in that period of time.
Monmouth planned to annihilate the Royal Army as it slept off the effects of the local cider. He called for a daring night attack, fording a deep ditch, the Bussex Rhine. The ride goes in search of this ancient crossing point.
They would have given anything that night to have come exactly where we've come now.
Barney has found the precise location.
OK, it was a large ditch.
But disaster strikes. Vagabond and Trooper Wakefield have come a cropper. They have proved how dangerous the swampy ground and deep drains can be, even in daylight. This could be fatal. Horses have a tendency to give up when stressed. The staff coax Vagabond down the ditch in search of the firmer ground of the ancient ford. With a combination of encouragement and brute force, Vagabond emerges from the water to prove just how vital the crossing points were to the success or failure of Monmouth's attack.
Good lad. You started backing off. I was trying to get him back in.
Thanks to Trooper Wakefield's efforts, Vagabond is shaken but unhurt.
Just a big shot. I knew something was going to happen today.
Wary of the ditches and watching their step, the battlefield tour continues. The rebel cavalry, still unable to find a crossing point, were spotted by the Royal Observation Posts. A pistol rang out, and the Battle of Sedgemoor was on.
And this is really the main killing ground of the battle.
A fierce firefight of cannon and musket fire breaks out across the ditch.
Most of the royal casualties in this battle are caused at this point by Monmouth's artillery, and the Blakes are killed literally just there.
As the infantry and artillery slugged it out, the household cavalry regiments charged the crossing points and struck the rebel army in each flank in a classic pincer movement.
If you're a poor old one of Monmouth's infantry or one of his disorientated horse, life isn't very nice for you. It's quite a frightening sight. You've got the best part of 800 royalist horse split in two parties coming at you, either side, swords drawn, knowing perfectly well that their object is to kill you. The cavalry action is a rout. The battle, as it gets light, is effectively over, and there's now quite a lot of butchery, and most of the wounded are finished off, and the prisoners are gathered together.
Monmouth's rebellion was over. 500 men lie buried in this field.
As you go past the memorial now, just go silent for a moment and just think that they might have been rebels that lot, but they were still Englishmen.
Whilst the trainee riders are enjoying the countryside, at the Windsor Riding School, it's time for Freddie's first lesson with Joe. In less than 3 months, he could be on ceremonial duty in London.
You can't force horses to do anything. We've got to get the horses to want to do the job. Because of the demands we have in the ceremonial season and certainly in the job we're asking is, if you force them to do it, you would not get the results you need. Sometimes we get it wrong. We're only human, and sometimes, well, hopefully most of the time, we get it right.
First of all, Freddie has to learn how to walk.
Everything we do on the ground is then transferred to the rider. So when the rider gets on top and he asks him to go forward, either off the voice or his leg, the horse is happy to move away freely. Just change a bit of direction. What I want him to do is to trust me and to follow me. So he's happy to walk with me.
It's all about trust.
What I want that horse
Joe
is
needs
to
build a good rapport right. with Freddie.
He wants to like me but respect me. So when I stop, I want him to stop. That's a really good boy. Trot on. Good boy.
I don't mind if he's a bit strong. We can always say, just come back. But this is nice.
Now Joe can move on to using a lunging rein so that he can get Freddie moving forward independently but under control in a tight circle.
What we're looking for when we're lunging a horse is this triangle, OK? And that's me, to his eye, back to the whip. OK, good.
All the time, Joe speaks slowly and calmly to build up Freddie's confidence.
I know it's a safe situation. It's about him learning that it is as well. And woo-hoo. And I'm going to go out to him. Woo-hoo. I do not want to pull him back into me. Woo-hoo. And walk. Good boy.
Whilst Freddie continues to be put through his paces, on the armoured side, the trainee drivers are also learning basic skills. First, they have to master the Army's treacherous off-road course. Instructor Danny is a hard taskmaster.
Change up, change down, get the vehicle moving across country, you want it flowing.
If they pass, these learner drivers could be in a war zone within days.
They're expected to step up on operations, get into the vehicles and crack on. So I try to get them to a higher standard, all right, prior to getting there to the units.
All this needs to be done with a little bit of speed as well, all right? So if you're going this slow across the battlefield, OK, the enemy will pick you up and you'll be gone.
The ultimate test for the drivers is the knife edge. Get it wrong and the vehicle will flip.
That's wicked. I like how the backing of the back with up an angle and coming back down. No, you can't beat it, trust me. You can't beat it.
It's like being at Alton Towers. Sky, then ground, all in the space of a couple of seconds. Out in Iraq, or during their army career when they're out driving, going to come across various obstacles, so therefore we must ensure that everything's in place for them to do it.
In the afternoon, the troopers head for the quiet country lanes of Dorset. It's a far cry from war zone road conditions, but for these learner drivers, navigating a tank through small villages is still a massive challenge.
Right. On. You never know what's going to pop out. All right, some people always pop out by you. Yeah, crack on, you're clear.
Reeling from his mayhem with the cones, Jason Glasgow's on-road performance seriously lacks self-belief.
The major problem was with your driving from the start to the finish was you're too slow. Down that road, I counted at least 12 speed signs saying 40 miles an hour. We did 25 miles an hour. Obviously, you're not going to pass your driving test. So we have got a lot of work to do between now and 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, and that's down to you.
In Windsor, Freddie, the young cavalry black, is moving on to the next stage of his training. Joe Weller wants to see how Freddie will react to taking the weight of a man on his back.
Right, you ready?
Yeah.
OK, and up we go gently.
Ooh, boy.
Okay, big pats, ankle bets.
Boy.
That's it.
Fella.
So we're just going to move him forward, ankle golder.
Good boy.
Just turn him towards us.
Good boy.
That's good.
Boy.
You keep walking, face your front.
Joe may have broken in hundreds of horses over his career, but every one reacts differently.
Walk on.
Come on then.
So he's just feeling the weight now. He's just feeling the movement of a rider, just laid across. Big pat, ankle bets. So just a little bit of break, he can then suddenly relax and then we can get back to it.
Encouraged by Freddie's apparent laid-back attitude, Joe decides to press his advantage and see whether Freddie will allow Lance Corporal Adam Betts to ride him.
Good, let's go then.
This is the very first time this horse has ever been ridden.
Got your stirrup?
Yep.
Good. He's just on the edge, I think. You see in his eyes, he's just saying, well, I'm not sure about this, and a little bit worried, a little bit tense. Does he feel tense, Corbett?
A little bit, yes, sir.
Yeah, just feel over his back. When you're sitting on there, you can, well, they see, we call getting the backs up, and you can feel them arching up into your seat.
Boy.
Freddie has made amazing progress in only one session.
I think we might let you go, Corbett.
Joe releases Lance Corporal Betts and Freddie.
Now, how he's going to remember. If you see his ears, they're coming backwards and forwards. They're listening to the rider. He's concentrating. So he's got his attention, and that's what we need.
They even have the confidence to break into a controlled trot.
Don, good boy.
He's a super little horse under saddle.
Good horse.
Well done. Right, what we'll do now is quickest and best. Good boy. Yeah, that, I was really pleased with that. That was just the result we were looking for. I think this horse has crossed the line between being in his wild state and his captivity state, really. And that's the secret, to get them to want to work for you and to accept us in this role and this environment. So, no, really pleasing.
Like all soldiers, Freddie can't march without proper footwear. He must visit the Windsor Forge to be issued with a new set of shoes by one of the regiment's senior farriers, Neil Sherlock.
You've got to take your time, just let the horse know that everything's all right. Give him 5 minutes of just petting before you start to work your way down the horse. You've always got to let the horse know where you are. So as you come down the leg, just reassuring him. You can see how this will be very alien for a horse when it's on its first time, you know?
Freddie's virgin hooves get a perfect pedicure. He's in hoof heaven. And he takes quite a shine to his burly nail technician.
My head's a bit bald, so it's a bit of a salt lick. Come on, mate.
Okay.
So we need to keep the horse's feet trimmed as it would do naturally in the wild. So we take down what's not needed. And the babies always have a pull about, they don't really want to be doing it.
Neil heats and shapes the shoes in the forge for a customised fit. Freddie can't feel the red-hot metal through his hoof, but it's still a tricky moment.
The hoof wall is insensitive. They are quite smoke-shy. 126 here doesn't seem too bad at all. Steady. Basically, once everything's flush, steady, then that's the job finished.
With brand new shoes, Freddie is now only a step away from joining the mounted regiment. A month ago, the trainee tank drivers had never even sat on a tank. Now, it's their final practice session before their driving test. Jason Glasgow is brimming with confidence.
Just want to pass this course as fast as possible, you know what I mean, yeah. No, I'm confident enough for my road driving, so I really worry about that. It's only 20 minutes of concentration and that is it. After that, you know, laughing.
But his appetite for cone killing has not diminished.
Do that on your test. Failed. Right, we failed that.
Instructor Danny Stewart doesn't fancy Jason's chances.
Right, you've more than had the mileage and you've more than had the time on here to get these cones sorted out. You need to pull it off this morning, gents. You fail this morning, you should go back to your unit.
If Jason doesn't pass this test, his tank driving dreams could be over before his career has even started.
When you're ready, start the first part of the exercise, okay?
First stage of the test, the dreaded cones. Jason seems to be in a hurry to impress the examiner. But clip one cone and it's curtains. He shaves the chicane with only a millimeter to spare, but pulls off the perfect reverse parking maneuver.
Well then, so far so good. Once the other guys have gone through, I'll call you all forward and brief you for the road drive, okay? Sure.
Today's a big day for Freddie the horse, too. He and 16 other young horses will be selected into their squadrons, the Lifeguards or the Blues and Royals. Freddie's getting a clip, pick and shave. He's got to gleam to impress. In charge of today's selection process is Lance Corporal of Horse Charlie Smith.
This is the first chance the regiment gets to look at our horses and what we've been doing. This is the culmination of everything we do, getting them trained and getting them ready so the squadrons can come in and say, right, we like this horse, we like that horse, it'd be perfect for what we need. Let's have a look and see what you've supplied for us. We've got a big, wide variety of horses, some which will be better standard horses, okay, and stand on parade, whereas some will be good for Queen's Lifeguards, quite nice and smart.
Major Andrew Fox-Pitt, squadron leader of the Lifeguards, is here early. He should know what he's looking for. He comes from one of the most famous horsey families in England.
Major Foxbit's quite sly, so he might sort of wangle his way in there. We'll have to wait and see. Might want to cut that bit out, actually.
The Blues and Royals officers lack the same equine background and have decided what they lack in knowledge they'll make up for in numbers.
So we've got 16 today.
Major Mark Goodwin Hudson hopes to get the march on the lifeguards.
We've just got to do a bit more discreet research. This morning I'm looking for a charger, and after that I'm basically looking for good parade horses, which will be steady, strong horses, well-developed hindquarters, rather than something flighty and fast.
The selection process is just like picking a football team. Each side takes it in turn to choose the best players first. Traditionally, the Blues and Royals like the look of heavier, better-developed horses, and the lifeguards prefer less chunky mounts.
I'm not looking for anything flash. And in the pack, that 165 is a bit light almost for what I want. But on the flip side, I don't want the cart horses that the Blues and Royals normally have.
I think we're going to pick up number one anyway, because he won't want it. So we'll get number five, and then we'll probably go for number one after that.
Captain Rob Gibbs of the Blues and Royals seems to be bonding with Freddie, number 8126. But first choice goes to Major Fox Pitt. Freddie doesn't feature too high on his wish list.
178.
OK, 178.
Down here. But I'm looking for charges at the moment. I'm short of those, and I'm also looking for basic troop horses.
The Blues and Royals have 8146.
I'll go with you. 180.
180. You join the lifeguards.
With Fox Pitt looking for elegant officer mounts and Goodwin Hudson seeking heavy troop horses, Freddie falls between the two wish lists.
OK, we'll have 8126.
Finally, the Blues and Royals pick Freddie. He will remain at Windsor until ready for ceremonial duty. But Jason Glasgow still faces the challenge of the Dorset Roads before he qualifies for armoured duty. On public roads, he's a major obstruction. It's vital he sticks with the flow of traffic by keeping his speed up. They return to base, awaiting the examiner's final decision. Instructor Danny collects their results. It's good news all round.
He needed to pass.
He's like, I'm going to cry if I haven't passed.
Everybody happy?
Yes,
big smile on everybody's face. Yeah.
Bands of confidence.
All that hard work's paid off, hasn't it? No.
It was OK. It was OK. You know, I know I would have passed, you know, because I went out with that confidence. And it paid off in the long run. It paid off, so I'm quite chuffed about it.
Now they have their driving test, these troopers could be on operations within weeks. Next time on the Queen's Cavalry, behind the scenes at Trooping the Colour.
Carry a sword, young man.
Meet the Queen's chief ceremonial bodyguard.
They wouldn't regard me necessarily as a very good close protection officer.
And in the riding school, could it be the end of the road for Trooper Van Loon?
When I ask you a question, I want an answer. Don't stand out here shaking your head like a little girl.
Household cavalry has dual roles. 250 horses and men serve as ceremonial bodyguard to the Queen. At the same time, the other half of the regiment is ready to go to war. This time on the Queen's Cavalry, behind the scenes at the biggest parade of the year.
Carry a sword, young man.
The Queen's birthday celebrations, Trooping the Colour. The colonel of the Queen's official bodyguard is close to home.
They wouldn't regard me necessarily as a very good close protection officer, except for I've lived with it for a long time.
And the honeymoon is definitely over for the 12 new recruits learning to ride.
When I ask you a question, I want an answer. If you've got a problem, you knock on my door and we sort it out. Don't stand out here shaking your head like a little girl.
One week before the Queen's birthday celebrations, and preparation begins in earnest, but it's not just for the men. The 176 horses who will be on parade are put through some vital, if unorthodox, training. The officer taking the exercise is squadron leader Major Andrew Fox Pitt.
This morning we're rehearsing. I'm afraid the horse is used to the crowds.
The idea is to put more pressure on now, so therefore when they go out in the parade, actually they think, oh, well, this is just another bunch of guys dressed up, clapping and banging their drums.
Probably the worst thing out of all of it is clapping, ironically. For some reason, it unsettles the horses. Cheering, everything else, they can get away with, but the clapping, for some reason, sets them going.
See Warlord here with Alex James on. Yeah, good horse.
It's all designed to highlight problems with the most nervous horses and riders.
That doesn't bode very well, does it? Good Major. What they're not, I see a lot of guys kicking.
Kicking?
Yeah. Doesn't work.
What, as they can, what, at these guys?
Yeah, no.
The horse, and they're backing off, you mean?
Yeah, the guys are kicking rather than squeezing, right? Get them just to clamp them rather than they're giving it a good welly, which then sparks the horses up.
The test also gives the hecklers a chance to settle some old scores.
He's obviously trying to wind up the farrier there. And they've had a falling out and fell last night in the bar or something.
Eventually, everyone starts to calm down.
They seem to be chilling out a bit more. And the guys seem to be relaxing a bit. Always end on a good note, as they say.
In Windsor, the new recruits are also under intense scrutiny, but for nothing quite as illustrious as the Queen's birthday. In a week's time, they must pass the first phase of riding school. So far, they've learned how to get on.
Right, come on, man, ride all day.
Get off.
Sit up! Let go, you bloody right!
And get stuck in with the polish.
You can never have too much polish on.
It's their last inspection before they leave Windsor for Knightsbridge. Not much escapes the eagle eyes of Lance Corporals of Horse Lee Golder and Mark Jaworski.
Pressure's on now, so don't want to impress me today or there'll be a bit of trouble.
One trooper who's feeling the pressure and isn't impressing Jaworski is Adrian Van Loon.
Don't interrupt me or I'll lock you up now. When I ask you a question, I want an answer. I don't want head shaking, bottom lip hitting the floor, all the rest of it. Do you understand me?
Yes, Corporal.
Right then. Simple, yes, no. If you feel ill, you tell me in the morning. If you've got a problem, you knock on my door and we sort it out. Don't stand out here shaking your head like a little girl. Stop being a man, you little tit. Understand?
Yes, Corporal.
He's struggling within the ride because it's quite. You've got to be quite a close team, and he's sort of segregating him. It's not the ride segregating him. He's sort of segregating himself because of his. He can't pick himself up and keep at the same level as his peers.
Mm. He had a problem yesterday with his attitude. He's getting it from all angles at the moment. So I think it's building up on him. Oh. And he's having drama with his kit. We'll get there with that.
It's just
the attitude. Watch him today in the school, because he does, like you said, he takes out his horse. You've seen that before.
Yeah, he does.
If he does it, if he loses his rag or back chats who wants in there today, haul him out. Just kick him straight out and I'll get in the front of the free.
All right. Yeah, cheers, mate.
Although 18-year-old Van Loon is enjoying the riding, he's constantly in trouble over his kit. There's a simple reason why he's not coping well.
My family lives in the eastern part of Holland, and they live, like, 40 miles away from each other. So when I go over, I only have a little amount of time, so when I go to my mum, I only have, like, a day with my mum, and I need to travel half a day.
Hopefully he'll open up later, tell me what's happening at home, and then maybe I can help him out.
This is the first time I've ever gone out of anywhere just to live on my own. That's why it's a bit strange for me. Not in good a state with the corporals.
Having problems?
Yes, Corporal.
Well, why don't you speak to Corporal Jorski? Don't ball it up. You got a problem, speak to people. That's what we're here for.
You gotta be like Dad sometimes, don't you?
Yeah, give them all a big cuddle and a cup of tea.
There's just days to go before the Queen's birthday parade. The man in charge of all things equine is riding master Captain Dickie Waygood. The son of a gamekeeper, he joined the regiment 26 years ago and has spent 25 of them on ceremonial duty.
A large part of the job that I have is advising, really, maybe the commanding officer at times or the squadron leaders, the second in commands, on really sort of horse policy and horsemanship throughout the regiments.
With over 170 horses on parade, it's a hugely complicated exercise. The troopers must be thoroughly prepared.
Once the boys go out the gate on parade, it's over to them.
Today they hold a full dress rehearsal. Keeping an eye on every hoof is Dickie's main job.
This is really hard parade because most of it's in walk, and then when we get down onto the onto Whitehall, we actually stand still for about 55 minutes without moving. So for the horses to stand still for sort of 55 minutes and then suddenly to move off and be expected to work in a tight formations, you know, it was quite a tall order.
On the day, there'll be a long wait for the Queen to emerge from Buckingham Palace.
The hardest thing is for the young horses to stand still for so long. I suppose really like young children, they just get a bit fidgety and want to get on with the job. That's what we're down here for. We just make sure everybody's steady on parade. If there's any small problems, curb chain missing, you know, coming undone, or horse fidgeting about, as we've just seen, then we just quietly go in and sort those problems out. Very different. I mean, you're dealing with a living animal this morning, and they react differently on different days, the different circumstances. And if you listen now, a good parade is a quiet parade. And if you just listen now really carefully, all you can hear is just the odd bright chain just chinking, but there's over 100 horses stood here and you can hardly hear a hoof moving or hardly hear a jangle of any piece of equipment, so yeah, it's quite remarkable really.
Although the rehearsal may have been a success, days of polishing lie ahead. In the Windsor Riding School, the second-in-commands of the two squadrons have arrived to check on their newest recruits. Giving them the once-over are Captain James Howell of the Life Guards and his counterpart in the Blues and Royals, Captain Rob Gibbs. Only 2 months into regimental life, and Trooper Glenn Forrest's reputation is already preceding him.
He's a big lad.
Watch this. I remember doing this.
God, Forrest!
Oh. That is...
I have to say, that's even worse than me.
Oh, no. My word.
No? What do you mean no?
He looks quite... He doesn't look like he's got any strength in his legs.
It's their first chance to grill the newcomers.
Are you a kit monster?
I'll try my best, sir.
Do you take pride in cleaning your kit?
Is Betsy a lifeguard or a blue and royal horse?
Blue and royal from Blue Troop, sir.
And what colour is that blue and royal cat badge?
Stay bright, sir.
How's Viscount?
He's a good horse, sir.
I had Viscount in training as well.
Surprisingly, one trooper seems to stand out from the rest.
What position do I hold in Knightsbridge?
2IC, sir.
Of
the lifeguards, sir.
Which is the senior regiment?
The lifeguards, sir.
Well done. And who you are?
I'm a lifeguard, sir.
Well done, you.
Van Loon's birthplace in Holland works in his favour.
Born in?
Arnhem, sir.
Even better. Why is that important to a lifeguard?
Because that was where the lifeguards were established.
You are a star and you are going to go far. I can see it. Well done.
Okay, good.
Since most of these troopers think they've joined to fight for country, James is keen to make it clear ceremonial duty is as important as battlefield training.
Okay, fine. Gentlemen, it is a short period of time that you are at Knightsbridge, okay? It is bloody hard work, but it will pay dividends at the end of the day. And as I have said, most NCOs would suggest to you that you do this first, okay? Now, when you are in the depth of despair cleaning your jackboots for the nth time and you're thinking, well, you know, I'd really rather be on Salisbury Plain living in a hole, wet, soaked through and eating my biscuits brown or whatever, that time will come, okay? If you particularly express an interest in wanting to be a donkey walloper the entire time, then probably the route for you to be, if you're good enough, is to go down the Blue Mafia route and become a riding instructor.
For James, so far, so good.
I have to say, I'm quite impressed, to be honest with you. A lot of these guys are doing some nice, smooth transitions here. And it's looking fairly tidy. Certainly an awful lot tidier than I was when I was at this stage in there riding. So, no, it's good. Oh.
But Adrian van Loon is about to revert to previous form.
Sit up. OK, sit back up then. Van Loon, canter on until the corner.
He then lets the side down further, right in front of his future officers.
Stop pulling on the outside rein. You need to give and take with the inside rein. That leg stays there on the girth. Your outside leg goes back behind the girth. You cannot expect your horse to canter left if you keep pulling it to the outside. You're telling it to canter right.
Later, musician Alex Miller tries to raise riding school morale. And Van Loon has got some welcome news.
I talked to the corporal about it and he's sorting me out some leave so I can get back home because I've not been home for 3 months.
Yet he knows the corporal's help comes at a price.
They're all really sympathetic in a way, but they see it, there's a dark side to it because that means I have to work harder when I come back.
Knightsbridge Barracks, and it's the day before the Queen's birthday parade. It's not just new recruits who must master their horses. Officers are expected to ride better than the men. This morning, they get a special drilling by the riding master.
Before every big parade, we have about 2 weeks of officers' rides, and they're to prepare the officers for the parades, just to tune the horses up and make sure that the chargers are working up to speed.
The officers come through the normal riding school system, same as the soldiers do, 14 weeks and 4 weeks in the kit ride afterwards. And really, they need to be able to ride well enough for the riding to be almost second nature, so they can concentrate on the mechanics of the parade.
And looking through the peaks of your helmet. Come on, Sid, get your legs into it. Forward, that's it. Gents, it's no good on parade being passive when something's going wrong. You've got to show a little bit of gust, a little bit of vigour and get on with it.
I mean, I've ridden as a escort commander and you are under pressure. You've got a lot of words of command to remember and not only do you have to ride your horse, not only are you very conscious that, you know, everybody's looking at you, but you've got to make sure that your words of command are absolutely spot on.
During Trooping of the Colour, the field officer, Major Andrew Fox-Pitt, will issue over 50 commands to the regiment. He also has to know all the orders for the bands and the foot guards. This morning, he gets up to speed with a quick recap of last year's parade.
Almost every state visit, the foot guards sort of make their own words of command up, which always puts us out of sync. The thing is, you have to learn your words of command very easy. It's learning the field officers as well and the bands, especially when they're not written on the bit of paper.
After 14 weeks at Windsor and a trip home to Holland for Van Loon, the new recruits have finally arrived in London to start their lives as cavalrymen.
Ever since we've come to Knightsbridge, the horses have been different. There's been a lot more pressure because there's a lot more eyes on us. And even the riding staff feel it.
They're quite late on in the ride now.
Things are getting hard. They're putting a lot of hours in. It's hard work in the yard during the day. Then at the end of the day, when everyone else sort of knocks off, they've got to crack on and push on and do the kit through the evening. A lot of them didn't finish till the early hours of the morning. And in yourself, you might think the kit's good enough, and then you just get ripped to bits on an inspection. It's quite soul destroying at times. But they're a good, they're a strong ride, so I'm sure they'll pull themselves out the hole, and we'll get there.
First up is an inspection from the riding master.
Pretty fast off is the worst because the riding master is the one you have to impress. It's not really the colonel with the kit, it's more the riding master because he judges you on your riding. And if your riding's not off the scratch, you just have to go back.
Good morning, sir. 13 members in all.
If they fail this, they could be backridden, demoted from the ride, and forced to repeat the training.
Yeah. Trooper Baker riding Zanzibar, sir!
Where do you come from?
London, sir.
London. You expect to be riding horses in the middle of London?
No, sir.
Yeah. You enjoying it?
Yes, sir.
But Dickie isn't here to pass the time of day.
Right, collar on shirt, dirty. Yeah. Please, epaulets tucked up underneath your collar. Screws again, knee cleaning. Dust underneath saddle. Both nose bands are not good enough.
Jim Hook, I'm riding Apocalypse, sir.
Where do you come from, young man?
Christchurch, New Zealand, sir.
Oh, well done. Good. You enjoying the trip?
Sir.
Right, come to me.
Sir.
See that there? Yeah.
Seen, sir.
Yeah,
even Kiwi, one of the more experienced soldiers, is getting fed up with a constant kit cleaning.
It's just the kit side of it that's really starting to piss us off. I mean, we can get it done, but I mean, there's a few of us who don't get away till 3:30 in the morning. And, you know, it's just one of those things. Some of the guys can nip their kit quite quickly.
Right, your britches.
If Kiwi is struggling, Van Loon doesn't stand a chance under Dickie's scrutiny.
The back brass on your peninsula brass on your breastplate has not been cleaned. Brass underneath the on your V-shaped attachment is not particularly clean.
He ripped me apart. In inspection, he tore me apart. He saw one little bit and then he just digged for all the little bits that I didn't do.
Brasses on your saddle are not clean enough. The leather work on the fans are not clean. Your girth is too loose. The definition is not good enough. And you, young man, are not up to the standard required. Why?
I don't know, sir.
Even though it's not the best kit you've ever done, you've still stayed up till like 12 o'clock at night and still put effort into it and then being seen just ripped apart.
You should have been able to clean three kits by 12 o'clock. This is clearly not finished off well enough. You're not up to the standard required. You're show behind the night guard tonight. I'll see you again tomorrow morning. If you're not good enough then, young man, you'll be backridden. Do you understand?
Yes, sir!
Thank you.
And then you're trying to hide it in the stand lap. It's all right, it's all right. I can take it. But he went all over. And just disappointing, very disappointing. And then he just went, that's it. We're calling it a date. And he just thought, let's go.
Right, I'll tell you now.
Dickie's had enough. It's not only the troopers who face his disapproval.
If it was the odd one, then I would have bagged them and put them on the night guard. But however, there's too many of them with the same points that should be nipped in the bud. Get those points sorted, Jones.
Right, sir.
Thanks very much.
It's the morning of the Queen's official birthday. As London prepares for trooping the colour, security of the royal family is and always has been paramount. The Honorary Colonel of the Blues and Royals is the Princess Royal. As such, she holds the title of Gold Stick, a military appointment held by a senior officer of the Household Cavalry since 1678.
Well, the Gold Stick, I think, in modern parlance, was the original close protection officer. They were the last lines of protection for the monarch. They were the people in waiting who stuck with the monarch, literally from when they got up to when they went to bed. And the troops that were with them were also the last line of defence. I mean, they were very much to defend the monarch's personage and the consort's personage. But it was literally, the last line of defence, the most trustworthy of the individuals around the monarch. you could argue that the close protection officer is still relevant. They have different ways of doing it, and I suspect they wouldn't regard me necessarily as a very good close protection officer, except for I've lived with it for a long time.
All the officers are fitted with radios, which link into a central police command.
That's my call sign in position, Emma. Hello, Zero, this is 93.
With the ever, I suppose, growing security threat, we're probably the closest people on hand should things go wrong. Although we never replace the police, we actually work with them, and as they keep on saying, they have primacy. But we actually are there for if there's any cordons or anything else that needs to be done if anything goes wrong.
Something did go wrong in June 1981 when a teenager fired a starting pistol at the Queen. Police rushed to apprehend the man. No real bullets were fired, but from then on, security was totally reviewed, and ever since, radios worn.
Hello, Zero, this is Escort Commander. Radio check, over. Good to go?
You happy with that, sir?
That's fine, yeah. Excellent. Thank you very much.
There's just 15 minutes to the start of the parade. Last-minute adjustments are made. Uniforms straightened. Horses mounted. Second-in-command of the lifeguards, James Howell, is not happy with his helmet.
It has several place settings on it. And if you don't get it in exactly the right place for you, the chin strap then ends up either riding up or riding down. So as I'm giving words of command, it will ride up into my mouth so that everything will become, well, like that, muffled, which then defeats the volume and it just sounds awful. So, or if it's far too long, it will come down here and start to creep to Blues and Royals territory, of which as a lifeguard, that would be a heinous crime.
Yeah, that's better.
That's the right place.
...176 cavalrymen ride out from Knightsbridge Barracks.
They look good. Regiment turned out really well this morning. Everyone was in good nick. And it's a good day for a parade. It's not too hot. Slight breeze.
What the crowds are oblivious to are the radio updates passing between the officers.
Hello, Zero, field officer. House of Cavalry and now mobile on South Coast Drive. Over. Roger, out.
Time will be 10:00 in 30 seconds. Out.
The Queen's Birthday Parade is the biggest parade of the season. In 1748, the celebration of the official birthday of the sovereign was amalgamated with the Trooping of the Colour, a tradition going back to the days when the colours, or regimental flag of the regiment, was trooped in front of the soldiers to make sure everyone could recognise their flag in battle. The colours are trooped in front of the Queen, who watches all the proceedings with an expert eye.
She's seen more of these than anybody. And she's got a very sharp eye, and she really knows what she's looking for and if things are done professionally or not. Been here for 20 minutes now, so...
Carry a sword, young man. Wake up.
We've got to strive for excellence all the time. And, you know, in sport and... In sport and what we do in war, there's no compromise. If you compromise, you get it second best and you come second. But I've got a few years left, and getting towards the end of your time, you start to sort of pine for it more and more, and you actually realise what you're going to have to let go of eventually.
Today's proceedings gets the Royal Seal of Approval.
I think that's one of the best parades I've seen in a long time. It all seemed to go really well.
You know, get the small things right and the big picture look after itself. So overall, horses were steady. Everybody's going to go home safely. Good parade.
At the other end of the scale, the new recruits still have a very long way to go before they reach the required level of excellence. The following day, they face the riding master's next inspection.
Just watch now the leading file.
But he's immediately underwhelmed.
Look over your shoulder, and you're leaving the rear of the ride behind.
The 6-5 looks like he's got a monkey on his back in his ear.
Trooper Forrest. So.
Forrest, draw your shoulders back. That's it. Now look at me, Forrest. You're sat like this. Just relax.
From start, we were just all in crap order, going round his dressings and stuff like that. And when Metcalf did it, it weren't Metcalf's fault, I'm not blaming him at all.
Just win. Tit-top, big stall. Tit-top, big stall.
Come on, let's do that again, gentlemen. Slow yourselves down. Go forward the second file. Go forward and stop putting his teeth out. Now look up, gentlemen.
There's far too many of them. They're not changed legs, but maybe.
Right, halt, still. Gentlemen, just quiet yourselves down. Let's start riding with a little bit of confidence. Quietly trot. Then when you go back into canter, don't overreact. At the moment, you're rough riding. Let's see it again, Court Golder, on each rein. Keep your distances. When you're asked to go forward into canter, sit up. Sit up. Straighten your back out. And then the horse will trot for you. Sit up. Get on the inside track.
Right, Court Major, I'm not happy with this. This is not good at all. I know when I come out here that I put them under a bit of pressure. And if they can't cope with this now, there's no way that they're going to cope when they're bouncing up and down the mile. And they've got the crowds cheering and they've got the horses that are on edge.
Call Golder! You present your ride when they're ready.
Sir!
You wouldn't want them going in front of the commanding officer riding the way they were just there. So we'll have a look at them again tomorrow and we'll take it from there.
That's just Sod's Law. They cracked under the pressure. Yeah, the lads are probably really fed up at the moment that they've got to re-show again because they know that they've let themselves down. Court Golder will feel extremely let down. He knows that he's produced some good lads. So, yeah, he's more fed up more than anyone, I'd say.
He did dig today, but again, that's his job. He's got to put the pressure on every day and a bit more pressure gets added.
Some are becoming unsure whether they'll last the course.
I'm actually beyond caring because I don't mind if I go home or stay here.
Getting past the riding master remains their greatest challenge. Next time on the Queen's Cavalry, we discover if the trainees can make the grade. Gunners of the Armoured Regiment go to school.
Target left! No, it wasn't target!
And the cavalry looks back to the cold steel of Waterloo. Household cavalry has dual roles. 250 horses and men serve the Queen as her ceremonial bodyguard. At the same time, the other half of the regiment is ready to go to war. This time on the Queen's Cavalry, gunners of the Armoured Regiment go to school.
No, it wasn't target!
Dressing eyes, no!
The 12 new boys learning to ride for ceremonial duty will either make the grade.
What have you put in there to make these black?
Or face failure. And the cavalry looks back to the cold steel of Waterloo. Week 14 for the trainee cavalrymen of the riding school is make or break time. Over the last 3 months, these trainee troopers, most of them teenagers who have never ridden before, have endured one of the army's toughest courses. Each man has had to learn the hard way.
Right, come on, man, not all day.
Spending a minimum of 5 hours a day cleaning kit.
Just bobbing a jack boom.
Suffering 100 daily inspections. and falling off on average 11 times.
It's a good fall though. Good roll. I like that. Right.
By civilian standards, they have come a long way, but this is the army, and the course just gets tougher.
Come on, let's do that again, gentlemen!
Last week, the riding master decided they were not up to scratch.
The whole ride really have just lost their composure.
It's Trooper Adrian Van Loon who's been having the worst of it.
Your blanket's not folded correctly. You've got dust underneath your saddle on this side. Your girth is too loose. The definition was not good enough. And you, young man, are not up to the standard required. Why?
I don't know, sir.
It made me feel so bad, I just wanted to take off my crash hat, throw it on the ground, just literally walk out of the front gate, get on the first plane and go back home.
Adrian is from Holland. Despite being far from home, he's going to knuckle down and stick the course out. The riding master, Dickie Waygood, has demanded a re-inspection of his kit. He's in danger of being backridden or having to repeat as much of the course as it takes to reach the required standard.
Morning, sir.
Morning. Morning. Ready for his re-inspection, sir.
Lovely.
No assistance whatsoever this time, sir.
Done it all yourself, is it?
Completely. The truth will be shown.
Let's go and have a look then. Thank you very much. OK, then. So, much better round here. Noseband is not good enough. Your noseband needs more padding out and then finishing off properly. Now, I understand when you put it on, you get scratches, so you should just nylon that off, a little bit of aftercare. However, your black kit round here, that's much better. What have you put in there to make these black?
Just put some hoof oil on there.
Ah, right. Well, if you put hoof oil on there, yeah, it looks immaculate now, but by the time you've ridden round in the dust...
It gets dirty.
Exactly. Right, your black kit is significantly better, but I'm telling you now, it is only just up to the standard required. Your noseband isn't good enough itself, but the remainder of the back kit is only just to the standard required.
Yes, sir.
You'll go in front of the commanding officer on Thursday.
Sir.
Yeah? And he'll be made fully aware that you've been a borderline case up till now.
Yes, sir.
Yeah? So you make sure on Thursday you've got polish on that noseband and it's sharpened up and your black kit is at this level, if not better, otherwise you won't be passing out, young man.
Yes, sir.
OK, because unfortunately, Knightsbridge is not just about riding horses, it's about your turnout on parade, because you have a huge amount of equipment that you've got to make sure is there.
Yes, sir.
Comprende?
Yes, sir.
Right, so I want to see that noseband absolutely gleaming for Thursday.
Yes, sir.
I mean, that was really borderline this morning. I'm going to give him the benefit of the doubt, let him show up in front of the commanding officer. I'll brief the commanding officer when he has a look, but I would say that he is on thin ice.
There are only 2 days to go until the ride, and especially Trooper Van Loon, have to face the Colonel's parade. Only if they pass that can they start riding in ceremonial kit. The Household Cavalry's state kit reflects their long history. The steel cuirass breastplate dates from 1842 and the ceremonial sword, 1892. The battle honours go back 350 years. The regiment's history is the key to its identity. Regimental historian Major General Barney White Spanner is researching one of their finest hours. It happened here in a field in Belgium 190 years ago. Battle of Waterloo. In 1815, a huge French army under their Emperor Napoleon faced the Duke of Wellington, leading the British and their allies. At stake was the future of Europe. Barney is following in the hoof prints of the Household Cavalry.
This is the field in which the Household Brigade spent the night before the battle. They got here late, and they weren't in the best of tempers when they arrived. They had no food, and they slept in lines as best they could, with their cloaks around them and with their arms looped through their horses' reins. It was an absolutely miserable night. There was not only a howling wind, but the rain kept up all through the night. It was, even the hardened veterans had to agree, one of the worst nights any of them had ever spent.
It was hardly the ideal preparation for the enormous battle to come.
Napoleon was supremely confident on the morning of Waterloo. He therefore ordered the main striking corps of his army to advance and smash a hole straight up the Brussels Road and through Wellington's thin line of infantry behind the ridge.
The only thing that could protect the foot soldiers from the French attack was the household cavalry. Today, nearly two centuries later, the tradition of mounted warfare lives on in ceremonial duty.
By the French! Look in!
As part of his job as riding master, Captain Dickie Waygood has to perfect the horseback fighting skills of his regimental ancestors and pass them on to the cavalrymen of today.
OK, a little bit of sword drill. Doesn't do any harm to have a tune-up now and again. Mark, can I borrow your sword, please? OK, there's no need to move the elbow at all. So we go simply from there to there. So the hilt's turned out, the cutting edge of the blade is out.
Slope, swords!
Cutting edge there, elbow into the side. Mark over it, that's it there, spot on. From here, we push the whole weight forward, twisting the hilt uppermost. Here we go then, to there.
Engage, swords!
That's it, so the whole weight's there, and you can feel there, Marco, you've got the whole weight of your body to push that into your enemy.
Travelling at a speed of about 30 miles an hour, 3/4 of a ton in weight, including the rider with all his uniform on, being driven into an opponent, then you can imagine the damage that this would do. Engage! And you feel the whole weight there is pushed into the target, so the weight of your body is going to drive the sword home. Well done. Good.
Key to the drill is the style of the sword itself. At the Battle of Waterloo, the old-fashioned British sword was designed purely for cutting the enemy.
This sword here was used at Waterloo. And what's quite unique about this sword is this is a slashing sword. There's a lot of weight in it, and it was designed to slash your enemy. With this sword, we were inflicting a lot of damage by removing the odd limb here and there. And for the French, this had a terrible effect on their morale when they saw a lot of their own actually riding around with amputated limbs or very deep cuts wherever.
Using the British cavalry's slashing sword at Waterloo required a set series of drills.
So here we go, let's just put it into action and see what it does. At the slope, to the carry, to the pre-guard, to the guard.
And the cut!
Imagine the damage you'll insert on an enemy. I mean, look at this, that's just the weight of the sword itself. I mean, I wouldn't call myself a professional swordsman by any stretch of the imagination, but just an amazing piece of equipment, and it must have been daunting having them coming towards you like this.
In 1815, the household cavalry relied on their skill with horses and swords to defeat the enemy. 200 years later, they rely on their ability with tanks and guns. The armoured regiment is constantly training for war. At the Army's Gunnery School in Dorset, 12 new Scimitar tank gunners are heading for the live firing ranges.
You'll see a marker, and then just below that, there's another black target with a sandy coloured background.
Everyone's Corporal of Horse John Irwin briefs the troopers on what targets they will be trying to hit.
I'm just trying to distinguish between the main armaments and the coaxial targets.
Everything up until now has been in a classroom, so he's getting used to the recoil with a gun and of actually firing live.
For Trooper Michael Hounsome, it is the first time he's been allowed to fire live rounds.
Firing now!
As part of the Household Cavalry's battlefield reconnaissance role, the main armament is used primarily for self-defense. The targets on the range are both static and moving.
Targets!
No, it wasn't. It was left and out.
It wasn't nowhere near the target. Firing now!
Same place.
Left and out, Gunner! Left and out!
There's a lot more pressure there. Your instructors are pushing you constantly, you know, because they're training us for a situation that's going to be real and dangerous.
The gunner uses two wheels to aim the turret. Left hand for up and down, right hand for left and right. Once the turret is lined up to the target, he selects either the 30mm cannon or the 7.62mm machine gun. One in four rounds is a tracer, phosphorus-tipped so that the gunners can follow the bullets and walk the stream of fire into the target.
Target left!
No, it wasn't target!
Left!
Trooper Handsome is struggling to find his mark.
Listen, when I say sabot Travis right, I mean Travis right until I say steady. Then you start going slower, don't you? Well, let's start doing it then. I thought you'd be better at this. You're not. You're not pulling it off at the moment. Scan your arcs again.
Feels better when you're getting it right, but you've got to go through that learning curve.
OK, you must apply the correct direction, OK?
Yeah.
Because you haven't got the amount of rounds to waste just to get the rounds onto the target. OK, I know, obviously, recruit gunner, that's what we're here for, but you must be more bolder with your corrections, all right?
Fine now!
Well done!
Target!
Obviously, I'm a recruit gunner. I've never fired at real targets, but I reckon if they were real, your main concern would be the fact that they can kill you as easily as you can kill them.
Next up is Trooper Mark Solis, originally from South Africa and fresh out of basic training.
Your adrenaline pumps, you know, your heart is going. You're thinking, well, come on, let's get in there. You just want to, you're like a terrier, you just want to rip everything apart.
Target!
And when you hit that target square on, you go, yes, that's a good kill.
Obviously, their first time firing, so, they've done really well. They've hit the targets, they've done as they've been taught, so I'm quite happy. Kill the enemy, that's what we're here to do.
But as well as killing the enemy, they've set fire to the range.
We had to stop the whole shooting because, obviously, the fire on the range... So what they've got is a fire truck out to go put the fire out and hopefully stop the smoke and stop the damage to the wildlife.
Little fire there.
190 years ago at Waterloo, the air was thick with the smoke of musket and cannon fire. Barney White Spunner's research trip has taken him into the heart of the battlefield. The cavalry's commanding officer, Lord Uxbridge, could see that the French cuirassier cavalry was about to smash into the British infantry, so he launched a blistering cavalry counterattack.
They went forward in a trot, a canter, and then a gallop, down to meet the massed regiments of cuirassiers in the low ground just the far side of the ridgeline.
The battle hung in the balance. The British cavalry faced superior French weaponry. Their swords were longer, designed for thrusting, and far more lethal in a charge.
The 1st Life Guards and the Blues ran smack into 700 to 800 of the French cuirassiers. These cuirassiers were the elite of the French cavalry.
This bloody clash was to become a defining moment of glory for the Household Cavalry. The perfect opportunity for some of the leading soldiers to make their names.
Captain Edward Kelly was undoubtedly the hero of the moment, and there's no doubt that his action here was one of the most crucial in defeating the cuirassiers and the whole French attack. Kelly ran headlong into the commanding officer of the 4th Regiment of Cuirassiers, Colonel Habert. Running him straight through the body, Kelly then, rather strangely, in the chaos of a cavalry charge, dismounts to cut off his epaulettes, which he wants to keep as a trophy. The effect of their colonel going down and the impact of a Lifeguards and the Blues charge was too much, even for these elite cuirassiers, and within 5 or 6 minutes they were sent reeling back to an area of a sandpit, which used to be roughly where that house is now on the Brussels Road, with the trees around it.
On the other flank from Kelly, the 2nd Lifeguards entered the fray.
Pride of place amongst the 2nd Lifeguards in this engagement must go to Corporal Shaw. He was a giant of a man and a huge regimental character who worked out a very effective technique. Knowing that their swords were shorter than the cuirassiers, and the label to break, their policy was to hit them in the head with a hilt. Shaw called it topple them or turn them. It worked remarkably well. They killed 10 men in the bottom down here. He's reputed to have killed another 10 men, his sword to have broken him to have lost the hilt, and he was last seen having taken off his helmet and using it as a flail around his head, knocking down French lancers.
Shaw's body was found the next day on a dung heap, surrounded by French dead. By the narrowest of margins, Wellington's forces had won the day. The French threat to Europe died at Waterloo. Napoleon had fought his last battle. 200 years ago, battles stopped at dusk. Today, troops are expected to fight in the dark. The trainee gunners regroup for their first night firing exercise. The Household Cavalry often uses the cover of night to penetrate far behind enemy lines.
That's too big a ranging burst. Too big a ranging burst. 4 to 5. No. Ranging burst. You're not on target yet, are you?
Instructor John Irwin has a direct style of tuition.
No, the one you were on, clown!
But Trooper Mark Solis is enjoying every minute.
Tonight we've just been doing our first live firing at night time, which was obviously a first, but absolutely brilliant.
Night firing requires using the Scimitar's thermal imaging capabilities.
Target! Firing now!
You can obviously see more of what your rounds are doing than during the day, with the tracer and all that. And the machine gun, oh, absolutely brilliant.
Well done, well done! He's doing really well. Obviously, because of the brilliant sights we've got, the thermal sight system allows us to hit targetry.
Target!
And pick up things as well in the night time as it does in the daytime. So that's what makes us a good fighting force at night.
Target! Firing now!
The feelings, the sounds, there's no way to describe it, but just you have to be there to feel it, if you know what I mean.
Once these troopers have completed the gunnery course, they could find themselves deployed on active duty anywhere in the world within weeks. At Knightsbridge, the 12 new recruits have also been suffering sleepless nights. After 14 grueling weeks, the day of their pass-out test has finally arrived.
It's a big one today. They get their SD hats, the green hats we wear, so they don't have to walk around in a berry anymore. So they don't look like the new boys. They'll fit in more with the regiment. And it's the first step to them passing out as a fully fledged household cavalryman. So they're all up for it.
Everyone's a tad bit uptight. But I mean, we can't wait. We really can't. It's a huge step for us.
I guarantee I'll get in there and it'll be more work saddle, more work black kit, more work brasses, and she'll be on the night goal.
Glenn Forrest has been polishing his fingers to the bone.
And we're up till silly hours. Again, doing the kit, doing the saddle. Just trying to get a decent turnout or whatever. Whether or not it pays off or not, I don't know. I mean, it all depends on what Mount Colonel's in.
Adrian Van Loon is not convinced he's going to make the grade.
You're thinking to yourself, I'm going to fail this because I cannot do better than what I'm doing now. And they're still picking me up for loads of stuff. And you just want to do something else.
My folks back home, they can't get enough of it. They love it. They're so proud of me and stuff, so that means a lot. Pockles is proud of me.
It's not only the trainees who are under examination. Riding instructor Lee Golder wants his pupils to give a good account of the work he's put in.
Hoping they don't buckle like they did on the rider master's inspection. That was the toughest one. So hopefully today it shouldn't be that much pressure and it should go without any glitches. Fingers crossed.
The test is in three stages, starting with the dreaded kit inspection, followed by riding drills, and finally, jumping.
It's the waiting that kills. This is all about the army. Hurry, hurry, hurry.
Wait. Wait. You're late.
No pressure at all, you know what I mean?
Lieutenant Colonel Valentine Woyker, commanding officer of the Mounted Regiment, has a meticulous eye.
Troop Wakefield, Roddy Wakefield.
First up, Trooper Liam Wakefield.
How has Wiseman treated you?
Pretty well, sir.
Did you ride before you joined?
Only had one lesson, sir.
Really? With who?
My sister, sir. I won't really call it a lesson, sir.
And what does your sister do? Does she just keep a horse?
She just keeps a horse, going.
Right. And what prompted you to join the army?
My uncle, sir.
And what's he do?
He's ex-King's troop, sir.
So you joined the House of Cavalry. Is he speaking to you?
He's killing me.
Now it's the moment of truth for Adrian Van Loon.
Troop Van Loon running Admiral, Colonel, sir!
I never thought I would pass out because I'm not too good at a cleaning kit, and my kit was always below the standard of everyone else. And today I did it to the same standard, well, maybe just a little bit better than some people, but there were still people way better than me. And during the inspection, everyone came around me so that. Oh no, I don't want this. Go away, please. Just leave me alone for a second. At the end, when he said you passed the inspection, I couldn't believe it. And after that, I just relaxed a bit. So that was all right.
Thank you. Whatever, straight up.
Walk march! Leading file at the quarter marker, left incline, and chase the rain. And ride.
Having survived kit inspection, Van Loon seems to be finding his confidence.
Thumbs on tops, gents. Raise the hands. That's it. Well done.
Even Dickie Waygood is finding it hard to find fault.
Number two, section left.
When I saw them, Colonel, last week, they were very, very tense. Very tense. And I must say, at the moment, they look completely different people.
But it's not over yet. The colonel wants to see them in the dreaded jumping lane.
Can we now go forward to the jumping rate? Well done. All right, let's just go in the school, be positive. Let's ride them forwards. All right, strong, positive legs. Get the jumping nipped. Put to bed. Yep. Go. Well done.
Thank you very much indeed. That was impressive. And if you can show me the control that you've just demonstrated outside, then in here will be simple. But the main thing is, leave the worrying bit behind. And just show off a bit in here, OK? Show me what you can do.
Okay, first time down there, gentlemen. Come on, the first.
The best jumpers go first and get off to a promising start.
And the next.
However, even though he has been over these jumps many times before, Adrian Van Loon starts feeling the pressure.
Come on, you rode like a wet weekend then.
The horse didn't want to go. So after a while, I had to really kick it to get over the fence.
Hey, legs in.
So I got it over the first fence with lots of problems. So I ended up wonky anyway.
All right, make it happen.
And then it just stopped on the second one.
Now get him right to the base. Well done.
Well done. I literally went feet over the head.
Well done.
But I couldn't do anything about it. That was a bad fall. Bad fall. Couldn't make it go over that fence, even though other people could. But it's such... I've only ridden this horse 2 days now. And quite hard.
Van Loon's tumble may be embarrassing, but the colonel knows all too well how much guts it's taken to survive the last 14 weeks.
They've come an awfully long way in a very short period of time, not least of which is to conquer their own fear.
To round off the test, a spot of extreme saluting, name, rank and number whilst jumping without reins. Next up is Glenn Forrest.
Forrest wasn't the most athletic person within the ride, but you know, you've got to give the lad 10 out of 10. He's not really built for riding, and he does get stuck in, and he gives it his best shot every time.
Forrest, you've got to come to the centre of the fence, young man, yeah?
Circle round, Forrest, round the back of the ride.
I mean, come on, you're not going to fit through that gap, are you?
Doesn't say.
Forrest, no, stop. You're not giving the horse a chance. Yeah, get him going again. Soft with your hands and just, that's it. Just trot to the middle of the fence. To the middle. Well done. Good.
All of you, I suspect, have come an extremely long way. You've learnt some new skills and you've mastered a new discipline. I look forward to seeing you for the big day and the kit ride pass out. And can I please encourage all of you to invite your family and your friends to that day. That is your day to show off to your families what it is that you have joined and what it is that you've managed to achieve. Well done, you.
I thought that was superb. Performed well, flat work was just awesome. Section work was good, outstanding.
No one expects perfection after only 3 months. And despite all the ups and downs, they've all passed and are awarded their regimental caps.
Chuffed to bits. Couldn't even get on a horse for the first, like, 2 weeks. And, like, if you wanted to learn stuff like that on Civilian Street, you wouldn't be able to do it in the amount of time we've done it in.
Adrian Van Loon is more surprised than anyone at passing.
Before I came here, I took up riding for just a couple of days and it was terrible, horrible. So now I'll show them how it's done, hopefully.
Top of the class is Kiwi Hookham.
Well done.
Come
on. Okay.
I'm chuffed. You can't remove the smile. It's awesome. It's an awesome feel. You can't explain it.
Next time on the Queen's Cavalry, the regiment finds itself on high alert.
The indication is that these are suicide bombers, and the instigators of this are Al-Qaeda.
And finally, the riding school pass out in front of their parents.
He looks like a man.
Yeah. Return! Charge!
Household cavalry has two roles. 250 horses and men serve the Queen as her ceremonial bodyguard. At the same time, the other half of the regiment is ready to go to war. In this final episode of the Queen's Cavalry, as the ceremonial season draws to a close, Knightsbridge finds itself on high alert.
The indication is that these are suicide bombers, and the instigators of this are Al-Qaeda.
The regiment remembers fallen comrades from the Second World War. And finally, the 12 new recruits who have spent 4 months in the riding school pass out in front of their parents.
You consider that he's not even 18 yet.
Yeah. Return! Charge!
Knightsbridge Barracks, late in the ceremonial season. It's early morning band practice, but today there's a difference. 8 young horses are being introduced to the joys of military music.
Because the last thing you want to do is put them on a parade with a band, and then the band pipe up, and then suddenly you've got horses everywhere.
It's vital to test the temperament of all newcomers to the regiment. After all, they face at least 15 years in the public eye. The other newcomers about to enter the riding school are the 12 trainee troopers, finally learning to ride in ceremonial uniform. Today, they've all been issued with their cumbersome thigh-length leather cavalry jack boots.
Luckily, I've got a pair that fit really nicely.
I like the fact that it's getting more and more like the actual job, what we're supposed to be doing, rather than just riding boots and combat jackets.
Get your own, Skyber. You've really got to hang on to your equipment around here.
But not everyone's happy. Trooper Liam Wakefield seems to be losing his enthusiasm for the
job. I do want to transfer. Because career-wise, there's no career with horses for me that I feel that I'd be able to do. I don't see that as a career for me. So hopefully I'll transfer to RAF.
But for the time being, he's stuck with Eliza. It's hardly surprising Wakefield is feeling the pressure. Riding school is one of the hardest courses in the British Army. 15 weeks ago, most of this training ride had never been near a horse before. This school of hard knocks has seen every man fall off on average 11 times.
Another one bites the dust.
Good roll. Like that. Right, bitch, trot.
Since they started, each man has shoveled more than 3 tons of manure. Spent a minimum of 20 hours a week just cleaning kit. They've had to learn the tricky art of marching upstairs and down. Not to mention mastering the cavalry waddle, walking in jack boots. The ride has suffered over 150 inspections.
It's like you haven't even touched it.
What's this?
Did you miss the kit cleaning lecture?
I'm not happy with this. This is not good at all. Tomorrow morning after regimental drills, let's have them back out and let's see them again.
But at least they've had the horses to keep up morale.
Yeah, they're good horse.
Thank you.
Smile.
Yeah, good boy.
These equine veterans have always been one step ahead of their novice charges.
Ride, halt!
This is the final phase of their training, where each day they learn to ride with a new item of state kit. Today, Lee Golder will gently torture them with the finer points of ceremonial sword drill.
Now, this position for you will last about 10 seconds. Right arm up, lock it out.
They'll need strong right arms. On ceremonial duty, they're expected to hold their swords for up to 4 hours.
Position 3. Slowly towards the front. So the sword blade is pointing towards the ground. Keep the elbow locked out, Baker. You big wetty. After 10 seconds, you'll start to do this. Corporal, corporal, my arm. And it'll start to fade. The harder you work, the less we do it. Right arms up then, locked out at the elbow. Come on, Wakefield, you're flagging already, look. Wait for it. Recover! Tops! Kiss the hilt of the sword.
In only a week, they'll be graduating in front of their parents. It's not only a big week for the novices. Soon, thousands of World War II veterans will descend on London for National Commemoration Day, the last major parade of the season. During the Second World War, the Household Cavalry fought their way through the desert, Italy, and Europe. They were the lead units during the advance through Normandy just after D-Day. The regiment's own advance can clearly be traced just by following the sites of cemeteries where troopers are buried. 61 years on, almost to the day, young members of the regiment have returned to Normandy with a cavalry veteran, Johnny Seyfried, then a 20-year-old lieutenant in charge of a troop of armoured cars.
I'd like to ask Johnny to lay this wreath in remembrance not only of all the household cavalrymen that died during the Second World War, for all those who died in and around this area. Johnny.
For Johnny, these are not just anonymous headstones. They are men he knew and fought alongside. he finds the grave of one of his comrades.
I remember Corporal Allenby Young. Yeah, 60 years ago. He was a triple corporal of horse.
One of today's corporals of horse is Richard Bentley, a senior vehicle commander in the armoured regiment. He's seen active service himself.
It's probably quite emotional for him actually to come back and see people that he actually does know. It's quite poignant really to just to look at it and see how many young men did lay down their lives. I mean, just look at this lad here, the Lincolnshire Regiment. 16th of August, he's just 18 year old. It just puts life into perspective, I suppose. Just gives you time to just to stand and think and reflect on how lucky we are, really, I think.
The reconnaissance role of the Household Cavalry demanded bold advances through enemy lines to report back on their strength and take bridgeheads wherever possible. In the summer of 44, the Allies were bogged down in the treacherous Bocage countryside of Normandy. The thick hedges, narrow lanes and small fields were perfect defensive country and a death trap for armoured vehicles. Johnny and regimental historian Barney White Spanner are retracing the exact route his troop made through German lines. They've found a bridge that the regiment took and held with only two armoured cars. It led to a crucial breakout, punching through enemy lines.
Feeling a great elation, knowing that we could break out and be free of this Bocage country, which was a nightmare.
This was the spearhead of the Allied advance out of Normandy, a critical two-month battle that left two German army groups destroyed and helped open the road to Berlin. Within a matter of weeks, Johnny's troop was in Belgium.
So what did it feel like driving into Brussels then, Johnny?
It was fantastic. And I picked up the what I thought was the intercom, and I said to my driver, I said, Nobby, it's about time we broke down. And unfortunately, it went straight through to the adjutant. That was the end of that little sojourn. Yeah. And the telephones were working. Rang up my mother, much to her surprise.
Yeah, but she was quite surprised.
Yes, yeah.
Quite thankful as well, I suppose.
Well, yes, I hope so.
The Household Cavalry has continued to be at the forefront of most military operations over the last 50 years. Years on from Normandy, during the last Gulf War, D Squadron led the advance on Basra, probing ahead of the main British front. During this action, Scimitar driver Christopher Finney was to save the life of his gunner in a friendly fire incident. Finney won the George Cross.
That day, we all had a bit of a sort of a sixth sense feeling that something wrong was going to happen. We'd heard firing. We thought it was a Iraqi anti-aircraft gun. Continued to move at a very slow pace, up 2-3 mile an hour, at which point I heard a loud bang in the vehicle. Sparks sort of everywhere, just surrounding me. It was basically a wall of flame behind us there. So I weighed up the situation and thought, well, it's not really worth sitting in here with all this ammunition here, just waiting to go off. So I jumped out, jumped off the front, at which point I looked up and noticed my gunner was sort of attempting to get out of the turret, obviously injured. So then I took him down onto the floor, and the plane came back around again. And this was the first I knew of it being a plane, let alone an American plane. Everything sort of went into slow motion. The A-10 fires extremely fast, and they were just hitting the ground sort of one by one, and you could see it all happening. So I went to drag away the injured gunner around the front of the vehicle to try and get him to safety. I felt something warm and wet down the back of my leg. To find I'd had shrapnel wounds in my right calf. It wasn't too bad, so I thought I'll be all right with that. But then I felt it on the back of my left thigh, at which point I turned around and I'd also received a shrapnel wound to my left buttock.
Medivaced from the battlefield, he'd saved one man's life, been wounded, tried to save another man in a blazing scimitar, and found time to radio in a report. It took him 6 weeks to recover from his physical wounds. In Knightsbridge, the 12 trainee troopers prepare to ride out in the full ceremonial kit for the first time. Jack boots, gloves, gauntlets and armour leave little contact or feeling between horse and rider. and it's one of the warmest days of the year. Trooper Mike Kiwi Hookham is feeling the heat.
I was sweating yesterday, so it's twice as hot today as it was yesterday.
We really need a
hot, sweaty, anxious as well, because the boots are solid. You don't know if you actually got contact with the horse or not. When you do squeeze, you squeeze too hard, the horse is just gone. Tedcaster, the mighty dozer. When it comes to feed time, my god, he near kicks the doors and walls and...
It's the end of a long journey for these trainee troopers and their mentor, Lance Corporal of Horse Lee Golder.
At the end of the day, this is their bread and butter. Once they pass out, this is what they'll be wearing on Queen's Lifeguard, on the escorts. So the sooner they learn to accept the way that they have to ride in the kit and how uncomfortable and awkward it is, the easier it's going to be for them.
This morning, Captain James St. John Price takes the inspection.
Morning, sir.
He's an expert on dress and a stickler for detail.
Trooper Hookham riding Tedcaster, sir.
This is the first time they've been inspected in full ceremonial uniform.
Some of the hairs have been pushed back to reveal the plume ball.
Dress strap is fine.
Hookham has set a good example.
Well done, what a good start to kit ride.
But laid-back Adrian Van Loon is next.
You can't really see yourself, but there's a large patch here. Once you're in the kit, you've got to learn to be very aware that touching anything will make it dirty.
Adrian Van Loon has constantly frustrated the corporals over the standard of his kit.
I don't want head shaking, bottom lip hitting the floor. If you've got a problem, you knock on the door and we sort it out. Don't stand out here shaking your head like a little girl.
Then he met his match with the riding master, Captain Dickie Waygood.
Horse's dock is dirty. Your blanket's not folded correctly. You're not up to the standard required. I'll see you again tomorrow morning. If you're not good enough then, young man, you'll be backridden. Do you understand?
Yes, sir!
Thank you.
He just seems to lack the essential gene needed to make a guardsman gleam.
If you look at it closely, look at that, it's not being cleaned correctly. Can you see the rust?
Yes, sir.
That'll get you charged on Queen's Lifeguard, OK? From now on, it gets a lot harder, OK?
Yes, sir.
To ride in full state kit requires considerable horsemanship. Troopers have to hold all four reins in one gauntleted hand. The other is for their swords.
They're a good bunch of lads. I mean, I've taken nearly three rides now. And you do get to know them over a period of time, and it's probably, without sounding cheesy, but it's the best ride I've had, best group of lads. And they work together, they help each other, and it's just pure teamwork. And it's very rarely you find a ride like that.
In less than a week's time, their families and friends will travel to Knightsbridge to witness their passing out. With the ceremonial season drawing to an end, many of the horses and men have moved to Norfolk for their annual summer camp. The poor weather doesn't stop the horses washing off the grime of London with a traditional canter in the surf. It's also a quiet time for the Armoured Regiment in Windsor. For those not on exercise, vehicle maintenance and weapons drills are the order of the day. But this busy, ordinary summer day in 2005 is about to be shattered.
The terrorists will not succeed. The perpetrators of today's attacks are intent on destroying human life.
With the mounted regiment situated in the heart of the city, a squadron is placed on full alert. Swords and cuirasses are put away for assault rifles and body armor.
It's another good example of us primarily being soldiers.
although we're here carrying out ceremonial duties, we also have a military security function, particularly post 9/11.
Major Mark Goodwin Hudson addresses his team.
Just to give an update on the situation so far, there have been tube instances on the tube as well as on a bus. The indication is that these are suicide bombers, and the instigators of this are Al-Qaeda. Now, in terms of what that means for us, is that we are still at the moment waiting to be deployed. They have not decided yet to call in the military. This has been handled by the civil agencies, by the police and the rescue services. We have got over 144 men ready to be deployed, and London District know that. So if a military call-out happens, it will most likely be us.
The Household Cavalry have historically held a civil defence role. Traditionally, the lifeguards were responsible for riot control in London. Reading the Riot Act comes from the text magistrates used to read out to angry mobs before the troopers were sent in. This role has remained ever since. In February 2003, it was the Household Cavalry's armoured regiment who scrambled to Heathrow Airport in a remarkable display of home defence during peacetime. On July the 7th, 2005, the emergency services are getting the situation under control, and the government are wary of panicking the public by putting the army on the streets. The squadron is stood down. Amid the tightest of security, it's decided that the National Commemoration Day celebrations should go ahead. The bombings of the previous week failed to stop hundreds of thousands flocking to London to mark the end of the Second World War. The combined bands of the Life Guards and the Blues and Royals warm up before the parade. All these band horses are veteran performers, picked because of their experience, docile temperaments, and probable deafness, like 20-year-old Quarry.
He stands his ground. He knows the score now. He's done it many times. He's a good horse. We'll have to find another one when he goes.
Yeah. Farrier Neil Sherlock is giving Cornet a last-minute brush-up.
10 minutes for your horse if you've got a nice horse. If you haven't, it could be the worst 10 minutes of your life. He's all right. He's like a big dog, really.
In the stables, the saddles go on for the final parade of the season. 21-year-old Gulf War veteran Trooper Christopher Finney is also taking part, but as a guest of honour.
Going along, I think there's 8 Victoria Cross or George Cross winners going along with the Queen to watch the show. Not that many people get to go along with the Queen to watch, sort of thing, so should be good.
Since he received his George Cross, he's been a regular at palace occasions.
I think she actually knows my name now. Today's 6th or 7th time I've seen her. It's just a bit of a shame this one's on a Sunday. Normally I get a day off work to come along to it.
The George Cross is equal to the Victoria Cross, but the VC can only be awarded for courage in the face of the enemy. Finney's actions involve not the enemy, but the Americans, or friendly fire.
You can't drink natural water.
The Household Cavalry mount up and leave for Buckingham Palace. Chris Finney takes a back seat in a busload of Victoria and George Cross winners from World War II to the Gulf. On television, millions watch the Household Cavalry escort the Queen down the Mall. Lancaster bomber drops 1 million poppies on the Mall to commemorate the country's dead in all wars. This morning, the riding school graduates.
CJ, position one.
Dead.
Yeah.
expectant families gather in the parade ground to witness the trainee troopers' transition into fully-fledged household cavalrymen. Mike Hookham's mum and dad have travelled all the way from New Zealand. Mike's infectious Kiwi humour has never let the ride down.
He did want to be in the Paris, but he's found a snitch. He's done well.
It's been almost 3 years in the waiting. Yeah, very much looking forward to this. Quietly in my own way, I'm trying not to flap, but yeah.
Seem very relaxed.
On the outside, I'm relaxed. On the inside, oh man.
Nobody has found it harder than Trooper Adrian Van Loon.
Grab a duster.
He has made it to pass out.
I've had my ups and downs, and I have my very down point in a khaki ride when I was just not coming together. I don't enjoy it, yeah, but I'm not on the phase that I really want to stop this and quit. I'll crack on with the 4 years, and then after the 4 years, see what happens.
It's Trooper Glenn Forrest who has come the furthest in the last 16 weeks.
An idiot like me has made it through riding school, has made it through kit ride, and somehow wangled through his way through the system to ruin Knightsbridge.
First of all, Forrest couldn't get on.
Go on, get up there. Counter then, Forrest! Kick the bloody thing!
Then he couldn't stay on. He certainly impressed Lance Corporal of Horse Mark Jaworski.
He just threw all his negative energy into, right, I'm going to do it. And he ended up being one of the best, which was a huge shock to me.
But the one thing he has always managed is to take his fences in his own style.
All right, sir. You've got to come to the centre of the fence, young man, yeah?
The 16-week transformation is about to be revealed to their nearest and dearest for the first time.
Leading fire! The egg marker!
Lance Corporal of Horse Lee Golder takes his men into the riding school for the last time. Golder's been their mentor and father figure for the last 4 months. And now, it's time to show off his charges to their parents. Trooper Bobby Baker takes the salute for the lifeguard in front of his mum.
I'm
immensely proud of him. Yeah, I think he's certainly achieved quite a lot.
Less than 4 months ago, this inner-city kid didn't know one end of a saddle from another.
OK, so reassess the saddle situation. Is that the right way round?
But it was Cantankerous Old Quarry who soon had him licked into shape.
I think the horse likes me.
He looks like a man.
Yeah.
He's grown up. You consider that he's not even 18 yet. Maybe.
Starting me off, yeah.
Parents, we do embarrass ourselves, don't we?
Too many flies in this place.
Return! Towards!
Hyde Park's Rotten Row is probably the most exclusive riding track in the world. The highlight of the pass-out parade is to canter in formation past their parents.
Eyes! Right!
Trooper Liam Wakefield's parents have travelled down from Wakefield. Liam's lowest point was when Vagabond took him for an unplanned swim in a Somerset ditch.
This is something that I've wanted to do for absolutely years.
His high point was his first ceremonial job in front of the Queen.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah. It feels though you're watching it on TV. Ooh. No. Ooh. No. Ooh. No.
From now on, he is qualified to parade on horseback.
See how he goes. And he's come this far now, like, just unbelievable. You know, he's had his ups and downs, like, but he's stuck at it, and it's come through fantastic. Yeah, I mean, words can't explain how I feel today. It's just great.
That's it, nice and quiet. Well done. Trooper Glenn Forrest's mum and dad are frankly amazed.
Never in a million years would I have thought he'd do what he's done. So proud. It's making a man of him. He did want to be a tank driver, but I think now he's got with the horses and he's settled with the horses, it's made him. It's like, I'm a man now, Mum, I've grown up, but no, he's not, he's still my baby.
It makes a big difference with the parents being there. They really do want to, you know, look really good in front of the parents, so they try that a little bit harder. Really performed today, really have. Drills is the best they've ever done. It sounds corny to say it on the day of the pass out, but it is. So. Really chuffed for them. To see them now pass out and do what they do, it's a good thing for me to know that I've done my job and they can do their job to a good standard.
Trooper Glenn Forrest is currently serving on the Queen's Lifeguard. Mike Hookham is tipped as a future NCO. Bobby Baker continues to impress his extended family. And Trooper Adrian Van Loon has conquered his kit and settled into life in the Lifeguards.